Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Because I live, you shall live also." Friends, welcome to First United Methodist Church of Ann Arbor. We have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Arbor Baily. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. But may this time we share together also be filled with joy as we remember Barbara and we celebrate her spirit and her love. God grant us grace that in our memories we may find comfort, in our sorrow, hope, and in our death, resurrection. Will you please stand as you are able and join in singing Amazing Grace? It's number 378.
Thank you. God of all, who creates peace within our hearts, you have laid before us a life of love and hope, and granted us the love of mother, grandmother, great grandmother, aunt, and friend, who made us more together than we are on our own. We come before you today with quiet thoughts and unquiet feelings. We come mourning the loss of Arbor Baily, but we celebrate all that she was to each of us and all that she is to you. We remember a woman who shared lifelong gifts. She taught, listened, laughed, and loved. She supported, encouraged, nourished, prodded, and cherished us. She prayed often for all the persons and animals that were part of her life. Let your spirit of grace have its way with us, that even as we mourn, we rejoice in Arbor's life once with us, now eternal with you. Surround Arbor with a peaceful, heavenly life, and fold us in the memories of a life well lived. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Psalm 27, verse 4. One thing I ask of the Lord that I will seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. Isaiah 40, verses 28-31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even the youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Thank you, Kirk. And will you all please stand as you're able and join in singing Be Thou My Vision, number 451.
Thank you. There isn't much that can pull me down from Marquette out of retirement. But there's this one. Barbara June Moats Baily was the mother of five boys. That, in and of itself, is an open and shut case for her sainthood. My word, what a fun household the Baily household was to be around growing up. It was active. If you can imagine, a household of five rough and tumble, competitive boys, you get the picture. And in the midst of that was Mom Baily, known as Mom Baily by many of us who were not her sons. But in the midst, she made you feel that welcomed, that special. Mom Baily had a special knack for allowing enough rope for all the fun to happen in the Baily household. But she also, though, knew how to reel that in, teaching all of us how to behave and how to respect others. I'm not sure what her magic was. I really don't. But let me tell you an interesting statistic. Each of the five boys became Eagle Scouts. Each of the five boys was named Outstanding Senior Boy in their graduating class. Each of her five boys became the fine men that you see sitting here today. Mark, Scott, Todd, Kirk, Paul. She's extremely proud of each one of you, and the men that you became, and the families that you have. As I mentioned, Barb Baily became Mom Baily to many of us. Some of us are here today. Many of those who call her Mom Baily are not present. She had that wonderful capacity to open her door and dope love on whoever walked through. Paul was in communication with some of his lifelong friends, and I want to take a little time just to share some of the memories that they shared with Paul, because it shows her influence over so many. Paul Dunbar talked about her strength and compassion. Always a ton of people going in and out of the house, and she was there to make sure you had something to eat and drink and took the time to keep up with your personal habits. He reflects with awe how she did all of this with five boys, where he has his hands full with just one. Alan Zink, another good friend of Paul's, also mentioned and admired the fact that Barb had the quality of always taking interest in others. And Alan actually felt fortunate enough to become that sixth brother for a little while, as he lived with Barb Baily in between moves, but once here in Ann Arbor for a little while. He said he learned firsthand how caring she was, how hardworking she was, and how much she loved her boys and her family. She loved music too. Alan remembered her dragging him off to a Hill Auditorium for concerts. David Evans also talks about Barb becoming a surrogate mom at a time when he had no family close by, and commented that in everything that she never once lost the loving, embracing, nurturing spirit that we all have come to know and admire in her. And he eloquently states it by saying this: her legacy is the rich human landscape of her children, and even their children. With all the many varied and amazing stories that these dozens of lives can tell, it is a great story made possible by the unswerving devotion of one woman to her flock. And John Wayne put it this way: I soon became aware that the crown jewel of the Baily family was none other than the mom, Mrs. Baily. She was awesome, and her presence explains how a household of five boys could have such a positive outlook and impact with their family, friends, and community. And while by necessity, Barbara Baily learned to deal with boys, she had her influence with young women as well. As you can imagine, with five good-looking boys hanging around the house, there was some ladies hanging around me once in a while. And my wife, Carla, with some of her friends, remembers Barb pulling them aside and helping them understand that they need to make sure that they are their own person and to get the education they need to be able to support themselves. And sometimes it's just the little things that we remember well. Todd remembered her back scratches. He said whenever you sit down next to her, she would scratch your back. And he said it was a subtle way to show her love and how soothing that was. Of course, he does say that Paul probably took most advantage of that. When I was in communication with each of the five boys, and I apologize for keep calling you boys, but you never grow out of that status with your mother or with me. I asked them to share some of their thoughts, and some obvious themes appeared: faith, family, and fun. It was clear that Barb operated out of a wellspring of unconditional love that never ran out. Scott talked about his mom's integrity, her relationships, and strong sense of fairness. He said, it's amazing to me that with five boys and so many grandkids and extended family, how she always made everyone feel treated equally. He did share with me, and I'm going to have to quote this so I get it right. He said, however, there's a little family secret. Yes, Mom did have great integrity and a strong sense of fairness, but she also had her secrets too, like most human beings. Anyway, just between us. And Mom didn't want this to get out. She told me several times that I, Scott, was her favorite son. And he just said, you know, there really isn't time to go into all this. You're just going to have to believe me. Now, before the boys start pumping on him after the service, in all fairness, Scott did add, he says, truth is, I think Mom made each and every one of us feel special. And that we were all loved so much by her that each one of us was her favorite son. She had five favorite sons. There's one story Paul shared that he said all the five boys could share because it's sort of an inside family story that gets told every once in a while. He said it might come out differently depending on who's telling it. But evidently, they were all here for Christmas after they were all adults or in college. And they were here in Ann Arbor, and they came to the late service here at the church. And when Christmas Eve midnight service was over, they went outside, and there's this beautiful light snow that was falling around them, and in the midst of it, the mom just stopped and looked up and said, peace and joy. Kirk had mentioned that she always had that kind of awe to look around and just be inspired by what was around her. However, that night, with five boys, they all found it pretty funny, and they just all started laughing at the same time at her serenity of peace and joy. And so many times as the years pass, Paul says, we often would say to each other, peace and joy, which we would know is a reference to Mom in every way. She represented both peace and joy to each of us. So how is it that Barb Bailey was such a remarkable person? Well, as one of the many friends who was welcomed into the household and who eventually became her pastor, which is technically true, even though I always felt more ministered by than I ever ministered to. But I do have a prejudice that her strength, her compassion, her unconditional love, her joy, her peace, came from her deep, abiding faith. Her faith and her church were so important to her. My mother had mentioned she always got a kick. Actually, I don't remember if this is my mother, if it was Marge Whitaker. Marge, who's out here, she might have mentioned this too. We all grew up in Acre, by the way. Everybody grew up in Acre. Always remembering the bands coming in, and Mom Bailey walking down the aisle into the sanctuary at church, and the five little boys following like ducklings and taking their seats. Barb loved singing in the choir. That's why there's a choir rope hanging over the railing here, marking one of their own who has passed. But there came a time when she felt like she could no longer keep up the choir routine. And so she faithfully sat in the pew. Her hearing was not the best towards the end, but that would not stop her from coming and listening anyway. And she probably knew a secret that most of you know. The less you can hear from my sermons, the better they are. Mott was of the generation that is probably more comfortable with the traditional understanding of faith and church. But even when I went off on my tangents, she was nothing but supportive. Why? Because I truly believe that Barb Bailey knew she was the recipient of God's unmitigated, relentless love, as we have come to know that in Jesus. Now that doesn't mean that life is always fun, carefree, or even fair. She knew that. Life threw her share of curves. But she knew, as Kirk read in Isaiah, they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength and mount up with wings like eagles. One of her favorite passages was from Romans 8. It culminates with the verses, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus." Romans 8 is interesting in that it's the first time that we get the kind of sense of the sufferings that St. Paul and the first Christians had to endure. And it's where we learn that our Christian faith is not an insurance from hardship. Christian faith is not a system for self-advancement or to further one's goals. It's a living faith of a loving God upon which we can rest assured, especially when times get rough. And Barb knew this intimately. She lived knowing that nothing can separate her from God's love. And it granted her wings with which to soar. Now, Barb loved life because she loved her family so much. If God would have granted her 20 more years of living, she would have taken it gladly, so that she could dote more love on her boys and their families, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, her nieces, her nephews, her friends. But neither was she afraid to die. What is next for any of us is still a mystery to all of us. But here's what Barb knew. Nothing will separate her from the love of God. Not even death. And because that is true, there is a second corollary. Nothing will separate her from the love of her family. Not even death. Barb Baily has done nothing more than exchange a weakening physical body for an endurable spiritual body, and for that, we are grateful. So don't be surprised as you leave this place or are at some other time in life, you will hear on the lilt of the breeze, as if someone speaking, peace and joy. You might want to get a chuckle and know that you are surrounded by and eternally blessed by the love of Mom Bailey. I pray that be true in your life.
You stand as your people and join in singing How Great Thou Art, number 77.
Thank you.
went to the girl Peter because she loved being in the choir. And them being here is a wonderful part of what's going to happen today. So you'll find out about that in a moment. I want to thank Nancy for all of her help. Anne-Marie, of course. Henry, all the way up there. And Naki. No doubt you've heard a lot of the hymns that my mom loved through this service thus far. And I really want to thank all of you for being here. It's a way to celebrate my mom's life, and I know how much it would have meant for her to know that you were here. It means a world to all of us and all of our family. Thank you for traveling the long distances that many of you travel, taking the time to be here. Thank you for your personal stories and letters, for sending food so that we could work on other things. And I know how pleased she would be that you were part of her life. My mom spent a lot of time with her good friends working in ideation here in town. Thanks for making her work there a rewarding place. She enjoyed all of you. For my mother, life was about family first and taking care of family. She was the fifth of six children, and while still young, the family moved to Clinton, where she grew up. She recalled her father feeding hobos off the train at the back stoop at their house. She got her start singing with her sisters in ensembles there and continued that kind of thing all of her life. She loved to sing. To make ends meet, her family tended a huge garden, and she frequently was called upon to do babysitting jobs and care for children because she just loved it so. When Mom went off to Stevens College in Missouri, she focused on early childhood education. And after meeting our dad in Albion, she used the experience of teaching to prepare for the five sons that she would soon have that would become the biggest part of her life. Our mother had unconditional love and an unwavering support that she conveyed to others. She believed in us. It was a quality that you knew you could always count on. We made mistakes, a lot of them, some of us more than others. But she always encouraged us to pick ourselves up and keep going. Our mother had a very solid faith, and she lived it, singing in the choir, volunteering at various church activities, and preparing a meal for a family in need, and making sure that we five were in attendance on Sunday morning. Mom was a mom to all. She encouraged us to bring our friends home to have fun. She mothered them just like she mothered us. She took a true interest in people, asking what you were doing and how things were going. She believed in teaching her sons by example how to live with the responsibility and the importance of helping others. She had patience. Patience enough to raise five boys, and that was almost a pre-qualification. She was always working to improve herself and learn something new. There aren't many 89-year-olds that are comfortable using the computer and the internet, but she was. All of our lives, she was seeking out and sharing clippings and emails with words of wisdom for all of us. Our mother had a great sense of humor, and more importantly, she could laugh at herself, and then made all the rest of us laugh. And oh, by the way, it's peace and joy. There's a little lilt to it, and that's what was the funny part. And you know, she could feel it, and we all could feel it and laugh at the same time. So, and many times have enjoyed laughs over that. I remember a hat, as probably the boys would all, that she bought to keep warm when we were skiing. It was one of those black, poofy hats that were about this big around, and it was really fuzzy and furry, and we couldn't believe that she bought it. And we all laughed about it, but she continued to wear it for successive 3 or 4 seasons as she snowplowed down the bunny hill, which is about as far as she got. And laughter was a big part of our family, or it is a big part of our family. Growing up in Adrian, we lived less than a block from my mom's sister, my Aunt Phil, and Uncle Joe, and our cousins, Pam, Jan, Joe, and David, that are all here. And we'd so often get together and celebrate a family birthday, but multiple ones at the same time. Because my aunt had 4 kids within 22 months, and they were out in line with us, and so it was kind of crazy when we would get together. Our mother had a set of lungs, and she could use them. She could, and I think that helped her with her singing. We could hear her at all of our swim meets while we were growing up, from grade school through high school. We could hear that strong voice call us in to the lake where we had so much fun when we were growing up in the evenings. And she was a dynamite hard worker, our mom. She had to be. Everything in her life was times 5. I think about it. If you can imagine how many socks she washed over a 30-year period, the quick math got me to 110,000. And in Boy Scout terms, that was supporting 105 merit badges. And she made 16,200 sack lunches as we went through school. My mother knew the power of food. It was one of the big ways to harness the attention of her boys. We had amazing meals. Picture Thanksgiving with an ostrich-sized turkey. She would cook pies like a pro, apple, cherry, and my favorite, rhubarb, for every Sunday dinner after church while we were growing up. I can remember Mom spending afternoon making 6 dozen of her delicious oatmeal raisin cookies, and never complaining or blinking an eye when they were gone in less than an hour. Our mother loved music. Naki played some of her favorite hymns here today in the prelude, and we are singing some others this afternoon. She loved singing in her early ensembles with her sisters and entertaining at community events. Later, over college summers, she grew musical abilities on the keyboard, driving right here to this church to take lessons from Mary McCall Stubbins, who was a longtime organist here. Mom loved sacred music and being part of the chancel choir here at First Church. She loved singing the Messiah with the UMS Choral Union for many years. And more recently, she and I would enjoy it in the audience. Each time she departed, she revealed that the Messiah was a religious experience for her. Later in life, as Doug mentioned, my mom's sight and hearing were big hurdles for her, and she hated to give up choir, but she really didn't have a choice. She pushed on courageously, enjoying each moment she spent with family and friends. Mom wanted things to be special for the little people that she loved. She had lemon drops out at our cottage at Brown Lake as we were growing up, and later jelly beans for the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren in her home. She so loved to rock and sing lullabies to the grandchildren and great-grandchildren. She loved each of you dearly, and our mother had a special relationship with her nieces and nephews and their children. She remembered their birthdays with a card, beginning when they were born, and not ending until this summer. They all have lovingly included her in their lives and made her feel like a queen, calling, visiting, and seeking her out during our family reunions and inviting her on family vacations. She leaves a large legacy to us. How proud your grandma and great-grandma and aunt of each of you for who you are and who you are becoming. She hoped to be a model for how to treat other people, how to be intelligent, kind, generous, and faithful. When Larkin told our 7-year-old great-granddaughter Noelia of Mom's passing, there was a silence, and then Noelia said, I don't believe she died. My body doesn't believe it. Mama, could you please call Grandpa and confirm? At any age, it's difficult to wrap our heads around the loss of this special lady here on Earth. I can say our mom was confident with her faith and often said, when the Lord calls, I'll be ready to go. I am certain today that she was ready, that she answered the call willingly, and is now a joyous celebration with all of her dear departed family and friends. Thank you for being a part of things today.
Will you join me in a word of prayer as we give thanks for the life of Arbor Baily? God of love, we thank you for the life of Arbor Baily and for the blessing she was to each of us and to her family and our community. Thank you for her many gifts, her love and her compassion, her laughter and encouragement, her steadfast commitment to her family and her friends. Help us to extend to others the same peace and joy that Barbara gave to us. Get us to know the peace which comes with living a life faithful to Jesus. It is in Him that we pray with these words that He taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And now may the grace and love of God enfold you. May you know the peace of Christ within you. And may God's Holy Spirit guide you safely from this place. to leave first, you may follow.
Please join us down for a reception downstairs. Thank you for coming.
I want you.